Hey guys, my name is David Kwon, and welcome to an Hour of Kwonmunism, which is an hour where I just talk in front of the camera, wearing a tie, about a bunch of different topics. A lot of the topics in today's edition of Hour of Kwonmunism is going to be rather outdated. This video is kind of overdue. I've been meaning to record this last week, last Saturday, but I was actually sick. I was really, really sick, so I wasn't able to record anything. My voice was really raspy, and it was definitely one of the, I think it was the worst flu I've ever had in my life. I don't know. It was really, really bad, but I've come to overcome it pretty quick. It's definitely the first flu I've had since I turned vegan 3 years ago, so it's pretty amazing to me that I didn't really ever get sick since turning vegan over 3 years ago. So that's interesting. Might be because it's the first since turning vegan that it was so bad. I don't know, but my recovery time was much quicker than usual. I remember some of the past flus I've had, they've had me sick for quite a while, but this one, I think I overcame it pretty much after 5 or 6 days or so. And that's considering that I was actually drinking through it. Remember, the last video I recorded before this one was reading the Bible as usual. I think I started at Genesis chapter 31 or 32, somewhere around there, with the new drinking game, where whenever I read something in the Bible that goes against scientific common sense or my moral compass, I take a shot of whiskey and coffee. Mostly whiskey, of course. That's my Irish coffee. And yeah, I did that, and I did end up drinking quite a bit, not too much, but enough to the point that I got buzzed. Certainly was not the brightest thing to do with symptoms of a flu, because you could tell from that video I'm sniffling, my voice does sound a bit different than usual, I'm coughing. I mean, part of that has to do with the strength of the alcohol, but another part of that has to do with the fact that I had the flu. So after that video, it got much, much worse. I mean, I was drinking, so it makes sense. I was kind of dumb also in continuing to, because 3 days later, I also ended up drinking a couple more. But anyway, here I am. I feel like I'm pretty much completely recovered by it, like, by this point. So anyway, that's been my situation. I've just been sick and home the whole time. Which wasn't actually, it's doable. I'm not employed, so I don't really have a job to go to. I called out to this usual nonprofit that I usually volunteer regularly twice a week. Wasn't able to go since I was really sick, but they're understanding. I mean, it's a volunteer. Anyway, as usual, I begin my Hour of Kwonmunism with reading over the comments that I've received on my videos this week. I'm going to be much more picky this time around. I'm not just going to read every comment that I received in my videos, but just a few ones, few ones that I thought were interesting or whatever, just interesting to me. So yeah, let's do that. So let me pull over, get close to you guys. So these are some of the comments I received on my videos this week. Actually, week and a half, so it's gonna be like spanning 2 weeks, but there's not that many comments to go over, so this video shouldn't be too long. But let's get started. I'm still getting a lot of comments on my video about my student loan. So the video, I now owe Citibank and Discover $93,000, people are still commenting on it, and this is one of the comments that I got on it. So this comment comes from the user, YouTuber GSXWRX. I don't know if that's just if the username is just a mishmash of random letters that the YouTuber decided to pick, or if it actually is significant of something, a secret code or something. I don't know. But this is what GSXWRX says. I am assuming you're from New York. My question is, how do you live on your own when you owe about $93K or $93,000? With the salary, with a 30K salary, there's no way you can live on your own. Let's be realistic. Rent at the cheapest place for a studio in the city $800, and utilities, $250 equals $1,050, probably $1,500 student loan payment. You're in negative already and don't have food. 30K salary really means about 18 to 20K take-home salary, meaning minus taxes, social security, insurance, and whatever benefit. I like it that this person kind of tries to do the math of being able to live on your own with this amount of loan. I respect that effort, but the math is obviously, to me, it makes sense why he would conclude this way, or this YouTuber, it could be a she, but it's a really, really overestimate here. That's really what I commented back. It's an overestimate. $100,000 in loans, a 10-year plan, it's not going to end you up with, you know, $1,500 a month minimum payment. I mean, what I have to pay every month is still extremely, extremely high, but it's not $1,500 a month. There is the issue of rent and utilities. I've just been really fortunate to live in really crummy areas with really cheap rent, and so that's how I was able to do. And my salary when I was employed, I had a salary that was like close to, you know, 30K, or with my overtime included, I guess it was like 33 or 34K. And the math is off. That's all I'm going to say. You can definitely live on your own even with this huge amount of loans in New York City. It's possible and it's manageable. It's really challenging, but it's doable. But it's really interesting that I got that comment. Another comment on this video comes from the user Extreme100, all capital letters. Interesting, that's funny. So Extreme100 says, "How did you get in so much debt? What were the college tuitions like? 20k a year?" You know, this comment made me realize I didn't really consider the fact that like my tuition is higher than that, was higher than that every year. NYU tuition is just ridiculous, and it's gone higher since. But yeah, 20k a year, I wish it was not 20k a year, just the tuition, which is why my debt ended up being so high. Also crazy considering how the first year of my undergraduate, it was all paid for. I didn't take out any loans for the first year. We paid for that with our own money. So crazy, right? Pretty crazy. The next comment comes from my video, and the video is "If God (XS) exists." And this is a comment that I got from SameRH17. And SameRH17 says, "David Atim Kwan, this is a great video. If we have gods, I believe that we as human beings would rebel, because not everyone will follow someone blindly. Even if it is a god, there will always be an uprise." Pretty interesting comment. I mean, that's really one of the one philosophical point I wanted to make in this video, is that if a god exists, then no matter what kind of god it is, because the god is so much more powerful than us, we would have it would be futile to resist the god. Whatever the god says, hey, this is my rule, this is my morals, you have to follow it, and we would have to follow it. That's really the key point I want to make in that video. And, you know, clearly, like, I like in these videos, I get a lot of, in my videos about God and religion, the tendency is I get a lot of negative comments, and I get a lot of comments that try to criticize me, which is great. I welcome that. But it's also nice to me to get some of the comments that say something like, "This is a great video." That feels nice. So thanks for watching. Thanks for commenting. The next comment in the same video comes from Mark Landry. And Mark Landry says, "I think the saddest part of humanity in the face of religion is how much we stifle scientific progress, vilify creativity and diversity, and basically waste time and energy that could be spent benefiting humanity. Imagine what it would be like if all the hours and money people had spent sitting on a church pew, they instead were learning foreign languages, implementing eco-friendly community garden techniques, or studying robotics. In the end, isn't it all jabba-jabba coming from the preacher?" So I thought that was a really good point that Mark Landry makes. You know, the time we spend on religion and could be probably much spent doing much more productive things. could is the key word. I don't know. If it was me, I probably would have still ended up idling those hours, being lazy. But, you know, it's definitely interesting to think about the question. You know, it's like that song from John Lennon, like, imagine a world without religion. That would be interesting to ponder upon. So just a couple more comments to go. Well, actually, it's a lot more than I thought, but let's continue. This is now from a video, An Atheist Reads the Holy Bible, Genesis chapter 30, and that was one about the patriarchy, about the competition between Leah and Rachel having this childbirth competition. And I had a lot of comments back and forth with the YouTube user Battleship TX, and one of the, I think, the most interesting comment that the Battleship TX made in that video was this one. And Battleship TX says, he quotes me, first of all, this is what I commented to the person. Monogamy for love is indeed a recent historical development, and one that still hasn't reached many parts of the world. That's what I said. And Battleship TX replied, I've had many people, mainly from India, argue to me that romantic love is not a good basis for a sound marriage. They cite high divorce rates in the USA and Britain as evidence that parents are better able to choose a good match for their children than their children can. These are well-educated, affluent people from India telling me this. So, on this video, I had a lot of back-and-forth conversation with the YouTube user Battleship TX. It was a great discussion, I thought, about marriage, divorce, and all that. And I thought this was the one comment from the person that I wanted to kind of highlight. It is interesting, you know, I'm not, you know, there are different kinds of marriages. Marriage for love is definitely a recent thing. And it's also like a Western civilization thing, although many other countries by now have come to adopt it. I mean, I always bring up South Korea as an example just because I'm an immigrant from South Korea. But South Korea has totally embraced the idea of marriage for love. And, you know, it is a interesting experiment. Marriage for love is such a risky thing. It's why the divorce rate of countries that embrace marriage for love is really high. But I, you know, as I've said in my comments with Battleship TX, divorce is an important thing. And I don't think it's, I don't know. But I had a really interesting conversation with Battleship TX on my YouTube video. So that was just one of the comments I wanted to highlight. Another comment comes from my video, Growing Up with Avril Lavigne's Music. And the comment comes from Brent Blogs, who says, you grew up with her songs. People I know grew up with her. She's from Napanee, Ontario. So, yeah, I totally forgot Avril Lavigne is a Canadian, actually. And so that must have been something, growing up with Avril Lavigne. That really just must have been something. Because I only, you know, I've never met her in real life. I just grew up listening to her music. So, pretty cool. That's pretty cool. And then this video, why shouldn't polygamy be legalized? And I got a comment from Southern Rocker for Life. And the person says, polygamy isn't practical in today's society. Let's say a man has three wives and three kids with each. That's nine kids and That's nine kids, and if the wives aren't allowed to have jobs, how are they going to support such kids? I wouldn't deny anyone a polygamy if he has the means to support the wives and kids, especially if the wives don't work. I just thought that was an interesting comment. I didn't respond to it in the comment section, but I just thought that was interesting to talk about the practicality of polygamy. Although, you know, my argument against allowing polygamy in, you know, the United States to happen is practicality would not be good. Saying that, you know, it's not practical to have polygamy wouldn't be a compelling reason to deny polygamy to occur. It just wouldn't, because, you know, but it is true, polygamy is impractical in most cases, but it could be practical for some people. But, I mean, as I've said in the video, that's not what I, you know, that's not one of the points that I wanted to make in the video. Let's continue. And then the last video that I want to talk about in this video is an atheist reads the Holy Bible, Genesis chapter 38. And that was on Judah spews, you know, the whole Judah and the incident with Dinah, his daughter-in-law. Was it Dinah? I think. Anyway, that's Genesis chapter 38. I got a comment from one of my, well, this is a YouTuber that comments on a lot of my videos, and he has a really, he has really cool videos about Mass Effect and stuff. There's, you can see the link right here. You can check out his channel and his videos. But yeah, this comment comes from N7 Normandy 1, and the person says, haha, I was thinking that you're gonna get drunk at the end of this video, because that's what I actually said in the video. I'm just like, that chapter made me drink so much, that chapter in the Bible, that I was just like, oh shoot, I'm gonna end up really drunk by the end of this video. So, and then, oh, also another comment from N7 Normandy 1, next time, you will probably like fall on the camera laughing, and the next day you will do a blog saying you just forgot uploaded or something like that. LOL. I don't know. Like it could happen, definitely. Seriously, like I've just done Genesis and I know Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, even Judges. Shoot, just going through those books, I know that like there's gonna be a lot of chapters, a lot of verses where I'm gonna go, this goes against scientific common sense. This goes against my moral compass. So I'm gonna end up drinking quite a bit. So I feel like those books in the Bible are gonna get me quite drunk. So I don't know how prepared I am for that, but that's gonna happen in the near future, because I am almost done with Genesis by this point. This week, I will start Genesis chapter 41, and Genesis ends at chapter 50. So I'm pretty close to being done with Genesis, and then to Exodus we go, and after that is Leviticus. Oof, that's going to be quite a chapter. But yeah, those are all the comments that I wanted to highlight on my videos this week. So yeah, let's continue on to the next topics.